I know that using your name was a good move. First of all, I'm going to argue that the software basically generally sucks and it's not the human that is making the mistake. But before I do that, let me explain that I'm preaching to the choir. So I don't expect you to be totally shocked, but hopefully this is the last mental exercise you do and you feel a little bit of joy in what you do before you go home. For those that don't know me, I'm Brenno de Winter. Most people know me because I traveled on an OV chip card. The only difference was that I manipulated myself with standard software that was available and the district attorney didn't agree. But what was far more interesting was that the company that was behind it didn't understand their own business. And also the policeman interrogating me didn't understand what the case was all about, because they said, like, you traveled on a ticket that was you didn't pay for, so that's what you did. So I'm like, no, I robbed a bank. Because and they went like, no, you traveled on a ticket. So no, that's the end result. But this company doesn't own any trains, doesn't own any buses, doesn't own any trams or subways. The only thing that they do is move money around. In the Netherlands, that's what you generally call a bank. And the interesting part of it is that basically what they did in the Netherlands, give you a card, and on the card is the administration. So as soon as the cryptography fails, I'm writing my own book with how much money you own. So they say, like, yeah, but then we can block the card. Well, I'm doing the maintenance, so I can unblock it and keep on traveling. And the interesting part is, generally, you talk to managers. And let's not say what I think of managers. But if you give them a red sign, they keep on driving. That's basically what managers do. So you think, okay, he proved that the system is a failure and there are a lot of issues. So what we do is stop, right? Wrong. You keep on going. And actually now the system is very important to protect train conductors, because especially at the train stations where there aren't any gates, these train conductors ending up beaten up. So what they do, they close the gates at the train stations with gates. And this is, of course, the reason why you could say, okay, ultimately it's mankind who is to blame. And I kept digging when preparing what could be a reason to prove that it's mankind and that I'm wrong. Well, I found it in The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
On the planet Earth, man had always assumed that he was the most intelligent species occupying the planet, instead of the third most intelligent. The second most intelligent creatures were, of course, dolphins, who, curiously enough, had long known of the impending destruction of the planet Earth. They had made many attempts to alert mankind to the danger, but most of their communications were misinterpreted as amusing attempts to punch footballs or whistle for tidbits. The last ever dolphin message was misinterpreted as a surprisingly sophisticated attempt to do a double backward somersault through a hoop while whistling the Star Spangled Banner. But in fact, the message was this: so long, and thanks for all the fish.
So, for the rest of my talk, if you don't want to believe me, go right ahead, I don't care. The Netherlands is a country that has learned many lessons. For instance, we learned the hard way that you shouldn't keep repeating your old same mistakes, like slavery. It was basically a bad idea. But in the Netherlands, we keep making the same mistakes over and over again. So you have a woman who advertises her ID card, and I could show you a zillion of these examples. So we start to educate people on the level they understand. So what we have to do is pick up the signals and maybe learn what's really happening. And one of the things that the Dutch really like is to use the word cyber. So we talk about cyber war. So if you think about cyber war, let's first look at the non-digital type of war. This is the mother of all bombs. It's a rocket. I like rockets because you can, you know, if you don't like somebody in the audience, you just shoot it off. But thanks to my clumsiness, it doesn't hit anybody. But what would you do if a rocket is, you know, aimed at your country? What would you logically do? Yeah, you could move. But you could also you could try to intercept it, right? Well, here's the big difference why cyber war is different from regular war. Digital attacks are not that easy to intercept. Why? Because they use software bugs that you generally are not aware of and exploit them. So in order to do cyber war, you have to have weapons. Weapons are basically leaks in software. Now here's the interesting part. What would you do if you learn about a leak in software that you have? You would report it and it gets fixed, right? But now you're a country that also does cyber war. Now what would you do? Would you make the entire world safer by closing down the leak? Or would you keep it in your arsenal to shoot off? And you can't do both. So ultimately it wouldn't end that well. And let's be realistic, most software basically sucks. A lot of the software is really poorly written. Ever wondered why you can have Windows XP going out of business and still have monthly data leaks? Software is also being actively weakened. Think about the whole the NSA story. I'll get back to that in a second. And of course, a lot of the software, for instance, in hardware is often stolen from the Linux kernel or other software and then put in the market space again and say like, okay, this is ready to use. Now we've got people in the Netherlands like Amijn Hemel who do a lot of investigation in GPL infringements, but then at a certain point he thought like, if I can find out the GPL infringement, I can also find out which version they are using and what data leak applies and how to attack that. So improve the quality of software. Unfortunately, we have the whole story of the NSA abusing their powers to wiretap us for all sorts of reasons, create huge databases, and as of 2 days ago, we now know that even our most important encryption is failing because it might have been actually weakened. And then, of course, they say like, oh, this is all really needed for one simple reason, to fight terrorism. And then, of course, I could show you a slide that since 2000 and the beginning of PRISM, the number of death as a result of terrorism has grown exponentially, but that's not what I'm after. I was just wondering, is it effective? So then you go to the NSA website and you look, what is the reason they do it? And then at the end you read, in order to gain a decision advantage for the nation and our allies. Or basically, we spy because we want your money. Then you've got politicians who start to investigate it, and then they conclude, okay, it violates privacy, it violates the right to free speech, it violates the right to your religion, and it violates the right to a fair trial. This is from a report drafted by the European Council, and that means that basically this is an official statement that our human rights have been violated. So if you look at cyber warfare, it's being used for a lot of other reasons than what we would like. So always when you look at software, make sure that the bomb is empty and that you recognize the rocket in time. Now, the second thing is that if software is weak and you make one mistake, the results could be devastating. A nice example is last year I wrote an article about KLM, and one of the things that happened was they had a website, vliegtickets.klm.com, and this was used to generate airplane tickets. Currently the French do it because they do it far more effectively and without mistakes. So they forgot all about this domain. They didn't use the server anymore and the IP address was given to another company. There was a sysadmin who installed software and didn't know about updating and patching. And I rebuilt the server because KLM said, well, you know, even though the domain was pointing towards this IP address, it's still not an issue. So I rebuilt the server and started to look with average tools, and then all of a sudden I discovered if you do a Hail Mary or just throw all the exploits at it, within no time, you all of a sudden have three shells, and if you ask who am I, they say root. So basically, what I have to do is clone the website, And use standard software for that, and before you know it, you've got securegoogle.com with your username and login. This is not all that special just yet. It starts to be a little bit more into, by the way, securegoogle.com, by the way, is not by, owned by Google, but by me. So anybody who wants a securegoogle.com address should come to me afterwards. And you can integrate that with the website. Now, of course, looking through GRAMS, and I guess you all know that. If you don't know GRAMS, it's the search engine of the dark web, where you can search for all sorts of stuff. I don't know why they called it that. But you can buy IDs or SIM cards or email addresses, etc. Now here comes the interesting part. The combination of one forgotten domain with a proper setup email on a hacked server is the beginning of a total nightmare. Think about what you could do. I send out emails saying, oh, if this is a special offer, if you go to vliegtickets.klm.com, don't press the link because it's dangerous. And you have people surfing to the website, of course, with a certificate, leaving their details. And now, since it's an airline, this makes it even more interesting because people tend to give out all the personal data they have. That's generally what people do when they fly, they don't care about privacy. So I kept thinking about what did I do over the last couple of years that could illustrate how dangerous that is. And I don't know if there are any Germans in the room, I do know actually, but you must have heard about the German Lichtbildausweis, which is basically a non-existing identity card. And 2 years ago I used that to identify myself at the Royal Palace, at the Dutch Secret Service, all the ministries, the police, etc. Well, if you look at it, it looks a little bit, and the language is in Dutch, sorry for that, it looks a little bit like this. Alsjeblieft.
Dank u. Dat je het tijdsbewijs?
Ja. Je zult het niet elke dag krijgen.
Nee, inderdaad. Nee, was even de naam. Lichtbildausweis. Zoiets?
Ja, Lichtbildausweis.
Oké. Ik zal er nooit op komen om het zo in het Duits te vertalen.
Voting. Bizar, hè?
Je hebt een verre reis gemaakt.
Nou, je stapt op een trein, hè. Valt eigenlijk wel te doen.
Nou, alsjeblieft.
Dank u wel.
U mag plaatsnemen, u wordt straks opgehaald en dan krijgt u van mij een bezoekerspasje mee.
Volgens mij is het alleen al de sport als jij hier binnenkomt. Te kijken of het allemaal wel ruim genoeg is.
Goedemorgen.
Ja hoor.
Ja,
dank u wel. Now, what you saw there was one was the Ministry of the Interior. They are responsible for handing out our ID cards. You saw the man being in total panic, realizing that something was terribly awry, because he started to do like this and squeezing himself and all these signals that indicate that he was very nervous all of a sudden, but didn't dare to ask any questions. And the second one, what you saw was the Dutch Secret Service that just accepted my ID, and that was the end of it. Now, suppose what would have happened if your name was on it? It all started with two little mistakes. And the thing what you see happening more and more often is the combination of attacks and the combination of attacks leading to identity theft. That is really what is keeping me awake at night, and that is really what I care about the most. You know, if a company wants to be robbed by installing bad software, let them. But as soon as my details are involved, I think it's more personal, and then it's an issue. But it could have been stopped by taking out one of the two issues. Of course, the domain name, that would have stopped it in the first place. But the second one was the poor software. And a lot of companies really need to do a better job in there. We had some lessons, and this is a picture taken from the DigiNotar case. The DigiNotar case was a case where digital certificates were created that shouldn't have been created because they made mistakes over and over again. And yes, of course, it started off with the company installing software that was 16 versions behind. But still, it's software that apparently still can be used since we haven't written it properly. So we should do it a little bit differently. But during the session, it was really very interesting that somebody in Parliament said to me, "Well, Mr. De Winter, you're painting a picture that all software is bad and we are all fucking up big time, and I think you're exaggerating." So I said, "You know what? This is September. Let's call next month Leaktober, and I invite everybody who has a data leak to come to me and let's publish it." So I got it nearly 700 data leaks. What is interesting, out of those 700 data leaks, only 18 were caused by a configuration error. All other ones were mostly SQL injections. I don't have to explain to you what that is, of course. But that's kind of creepy. And if you look at the latest data breach investigation report, 60% of all cases, of nearly 80,000 cases, the hack happened in minutes. Where is the software, or where is the intelligence to stop this? And 99% of abused leaks were over 1 year known. So it's a simple fact that we make bad software and forget to patch it. Long story short, we are vulnerable and it's not getting better. Think about, for 1 second, think about how much money you brought into this room today. It's only a fraction of the money you own. Why? Because the rest is digitized. It's a number in a computer. So most wallets are nearly empty. With this quality of software, that's a pretty interesting fact. This week it was announced that the Dutch banks want to prohibit paper and coins. Put it in the computer and you'll be all right. And the book Martin was talking about is dealing with that issue, because I make the mental exercise, what would happen if we wouldn't steal any money, but if we would create money? So start a digital press, and we have got no fucking clue how much euros have been created. Think what would happen to the euro then. And then people keep saying to me, "Yeah, but you know, banks are properly protected, and they're doing a good job, and you know, their software is reliable." And then somebody came to me and showed me an XSS cross-site scripting leak in a couple of banks, and that looks something like this. Is there any Dutch man or woman in the room, or anybody in the room who has a Dutch bank account and didn't see his bank come by? I thought as much. So what should we do? We should really start to think to do things differently. I heard you had a session on secure software development, and for the ones who didn't follow that discussion, basically the thought is, before you even start to design software or build anything or buy anything, you start to think about the contract and not about the money and stuff, but you start to think about the risks and who's responsible for the risk. So first of all, you start to think about the risk you have. Then you start to say, okay, this is really what the customer should do. This is really what the developer should do. And this is really what the hoster should do. And that's what you put in the contract. In short, that is what the methodology does. It helps you think about risk before you start to write. I really think that would make a total different world. And when the people who developed this started to implement that, the first thing they thought was, "Oh my God, the companies who develop software will hate us for it." And you know what happened? Everybody was actually very happy. You know why? For the first time, the supplier knew what the customer expected. So it's totally normal to sit down with your customer and say, what do you really want? How do you really want your software to be delivered? What risk do you think you, what risk are you afraid of? we really should learn to take our customer by the hand and help them think. Because, as I've proven before, the customer doesn't think. They're an end user. B-O-F-H. Second thing is that we maybe should clean up our act a little bit. And maybe one of the things that could help is continuous delivery. Stop building huge applications, throw it over a wall and say like, test this. And then you've got 3 weeks to deliver all your bugs and that's the end of it. That's really old-fashioned thinking, and really think we should look at smaller steps to deliver our software and keep testing over and over again against all the changing platforms. Because the platforms you run on and the environment you run it in is changing all the time. So yes, I know it's a little bit preaching, but then still, I'll give you a couple of laughs in a second. It's about protecting our assets. It's about protecting our human rights. We have a right to a personal life. We have a right to privacy. And we are the group of people that can change that. We can make steps to do it better. So even if you do open source, so it's not free. And we need really more verified and higher quality code. And I'm not saying that you are doing a bad job, but I am saying that there are developers out there that do not want to think about security. So they do not want to think about protecting our human rights. We need to think about better architectures, and we all need to pick up a task. If you don't do it, think about the reality. There are forces out there trying to weaken software and weaken environments and have hundreds of billions a year to do so, and we have got small budgets to fight that. So we better spend that money right. Unless, you know, the odds change, this is the only thing you can do. And of course, we should stop shouting at each other. I know there are a lot of conflicts, and when you look at it, it's only about details. You know, be excellent to each other. We're a group of people that need to stick together. Of course, in the Netherlands, we can turn to politics and they will solve everything. This is the guy who always solved all the software issues in the Netherlands. He's called Ton Elias, and he did a whole survey into failing ICT projects, failing security, and failing privacy. And just after he finished the report, he tweeted a request to Microsoft, could you stop calling me 10 times a day from India? So Microsoft said, like, no, that's not us. This is basically a scam. And then he says, like, well, stop mitigating the issue, start working on the issue, because it's clearly not phishing. I guess this is basically the picture of IT they have in The Hague. So, yeah, this is what we have to live with. And then the results came in. The interesting part was they studied for 2 years and then said, like, you know, security and privacy, that's too much work, so we skipped it. And now to make it a little bit worse, if you are under parliamentary investigation, parliament is not allowed to discuss these type of subjects. So for 2 years in the Netherlands, on the political level, we haven't been discussing privacy and security. How good does that sound? Of course, the report was late, it went over budget, and it missed crucial conclusions. The only thing that was possible was it focused on open source and open standards again. And they had a brilliant bonus, and that was that Parliament fails to do its controlling task due to a lack of interest and knowledge in the field of IT. They took 2 years to figure that out indeed, yes. The funny thing, by the way, is they wrote also 7 other reports before that, and it had the same conclusion, so maybe they did copy and paste, I don't know. But the reality is that we need to do it, because they are clearly not doing it. So that was my shout out for today. And if you don't, you know, I'm open for questions and discussion. And if I offended anybody, then you've got all the time to say so. But I want to end with one final remark. If you don't believe me.
So long and thanks for all the fish. So sad that it should come to this. So long, so long, so long, so long, so long.
So long, so long, so long, so long, so long.
So long, so long, and thanks for all the fish.
Thank you. Any questions, any remarks, anybody angry? Oh, those two are really angry. That's a strong statement.
Okay.
No questions.
Thank you, Bernard.